mic on. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the February 2017 meeting of the Oldham County Planning and Zoning Commission. I am Greg King, filling in for Kevin Jeffries, who cannot be with us today. Before we get started, I'd like to ask everyone to stand and say the pledge.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everyone. And as a reminder, if anyone has a cell phone or any other electronic devices on them, please turn the volume down so that they do not go off during the hearing. First order of business will be approval of minutes. Can we get a motion on the floor for a discussion of last month's minutes? I'm assuming everybody got a copy. We have a motion. Do we have a second? We have a motion and a second. Any changes, any additions? Assuming the silence means none, we'll move into a voice vote. All in favor of approval of the minutes as submitted, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign. Motion carries. All right. First docket, first order of business. Jim, who do we have? Are we going with Amy?
It's the Oldham County Schools.
All right.
Election of officers.
Your mic on.
Election of officers, we're going to postpone until next
we'll
month.
For the election of officers until the chair returns. Here's the most current. Thank you. Mr. Williams, if you don't mind, I need to get the staff sworn in before we begin.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. Mr. Williams.
How are you all this morning?
Thank you for making time for us.
As always, I enjoy coming. It's a pleasant distraction from the craziness of what my job normally is. Annually, you all know that we bring the growth numbers and the projection for the district and the number that is set into the policy for the number of students that we gain per housing unit. For this year, the new number will be 0.326. That's based on our three-year average. You can see the numbers. I won't go into great detail. I believe that you all have had them. It hasn't changed much over the last couple of years. I will say that the projections continue to be highly accurate. We were at 98.9% accurate from last year to this year. So that's something that continues to be very accurate for us. But I will be more than happy to answer any questions that you might have.
All right. Questions? Commissioners? Ms. Albertson?
Just a comment. Astoundingly accurate. Congratulations.
Well, I actually give that credit to Dr. Arvin, who originally wrote this, and I've just sort of managed it over the years, so.
Very well, any other questions?
Thank you.
So, Mr. Williams, do we understand correctly the recommended figure for the coming year is?
0.326. It's on the three-year growth enrollment and growth comparison chart.
Right. Mr. Urban? Mm-hmm.
Typically, what we do is we make a motion to accept the projected number from the Board of Education.
Mr. Carter, do you have anything to add?
No.
Okay, so at this moment, the chair will entertain a motion regarding the Oldham County School growth figure for the coming year. Mr. Arvin. Thank you, sir. We have a motion. Do we have a second? We have multiple seconds. Discussion?
Mr. King?
Yes, sir.
Discussion point. Mr. Williams?
Yes, sir.
As you have reviewed this data, And of course, you've reviewed it and put it together and everything else. As you looked at it, what's your greatest concern?
There is still a great unknown for us in what growth will come from the bridge. I mean, we are starting to see things start to grow, start to become more prevalent in the county. For us, that will either mean redistricting to try and rebalance enrollments or get ready to start building schools again. I do know that in our plan that we have submitted to the state, there will be another elementary school added to that plan. So we will be in the process of getting ready to start looking at another elementary school.
Is there an area of growth that you anticipate to be the greatest, 42 corridor as an example?
I don't see, personally, looking at what I have seen, the 42 corridor growing beyond where we can manage it with the schools that we have out there. Now, the Oceda property and the areas of Crestwood and all of that, that becomes another question, Mark. And we actually met with Mr. Urban and his staff and started to look at that. And I had a very long conversation with Dr. Arvin about how we do projections. And being able to track the numbers of students that we're getting, or potential students that we're getting from each approved subdivision. And Dr. Arvin made a point to say that really the way our projections are set up, they're going to manage those numbers. But we, in a planning process, also had to be able to look at where is it coming, when's it going to impact. And so what I have done is actually taken those numbers, taken each subdivision that's either been already approved or is in the process of starting to build, take that 0.326 number, multiply how many kids we would get out of each subdivision, and then figure out, based on our current enrollment percentages, how many elementary school students we would get, how many middle school students we would get, and how many high school students we would get, and then turn around and apply it to our projections. Even though it doesn't impact the projections, it gives us another number to look at to say, okay, we're going to have to start looking at building X in this area based on what's coming.
So redistrict, build, or possibly both, depending on what happens?
Well, if we build, definitely we will be redistricting. But otherwise, it may just be redistricting to balance the growth, the balance the enrollments.
Thank you, sir. Thank God for Dr. Arvin.
If we may, I believe Mr. Urban has some additional observations to share on that note.
Two things, Michael. There is a, and you can explain, a LPC meeting that starts to look at this need for additional schools. But also, you know, when we look at, and we talk a lot with the building industry, we look at population projections, we look at growth patterns, we look at infrastructure. Our comprehensive plan is really, I think, quite accurate in terms of where we expect to see growth. What we are seeing is the market is telling everybody smaller lots, less maintenance, greater density, if you will. We're not seeing as many 5-acre subdivisions coming in like we used to, or even 1 acre on cul-de-sacs. So when we look at the available land for those kind of development patterns, we're talking with the Board of Education regarding where we anticipate that growth to be. And so trying to coordinate and make sure that we're on the same page when we look at those growth patterns, like we do with all infrastructure. Michael, if you would just tell them about the local planning committee.
The LPC is basically an organization that has school board staff members and community members on it. And basically what they do is they sit down and look at the needs for the district and develop a plan for us as a district when it relates to our facilities, whether that be improving certain facilities or adding to those facilities, like we're currently doing with the Arvin Center, or building a new elementary school, building a new middle school, building a new high school. Things that come into effect to continue to either increase our capacity or help us to maintain our buildings to the point that we can meet the needs of the kids as they come to us.
Thank you, sir.
The last thing I just want to add to it is the economy appears to be good. Our single family building permits has steadily increased since about 2009 and 10. It looks as though that pattern is going to continue. Right now, I think we're in a very manageable growth rate. I don't know where it's going to go from here, but we're keeping an eye on, if you will, how it affects all of our infrastructure.
Let me show them this. This is that what we talked about.
Let me just see really quickly, make sure. Just that top sheet would be great.
So when I was talking about what we had done, and I apologize, it's going to be tiny, tiny, but it was no. I couldn't get it to print big enough on a small sheet of paper. So what I have done, you actually see each subdivision, and when it was approved, potential when it's going to start hitting us, the number of lots, and then it goes all the way across to it, assigns the schools that will go to each of those, and then gives me, like if you look at the top line, it would go to Goshen, North Middle, North High. Well, because based on the size of it, we're only going to get one elementary school student, no middle school students, and one high school student. So it only estimates a growth of 2 for us. So I'm now able to at least do this for the subdivisions as we go along in this process, to be able to say to you all, this is what it's going to look like for us. Now, I'm not going to change how we do projections, because that has held accurate through the upturn and the downturns in the economy, and we've never dropped below 98% accuracy with that. So I'm not going to change that, but this just gives us another tool to be able to come to you all and say, here's what the potential impact will look like for us.
Thank you.
Mr. Horton?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And to follow up in the question Mr. McWilliams had about projections and so forth, have you looked far enough in advance that you can project about whether you would be building in the future on property already owned by the school board or purchasing new property?
That decision comes, Mr. Horton, with each new building project, depending on where the need is. Now, right now, we may be able to build the new elementary school on the Brownsboro property, so we already have that property. Or it may be on the Allen Lane property. We already have that property. It's not we're going to have to go out and start looking for property. We estimate, at least at this point, that we can accommodate the school that we need on one of the properties that we already have.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Albertson.
Thank you. Is there any chance that Liberty School might be reopened?
I doubt that. Now, if the 42 corridor were to grow, and that's the problem, Ms. Albertson, there's not enough population out there for us to populate a school, and if we're going to build a school, they're going to be a 700-student school at this point. It's not going to be a 400-student elementary school. It's got to be bigger because it has to be able to accommodate any growth once we're ready for that growth.
Do the students who used to go there go to North, or do they, or Harmony, or do they go to LaGrange, or where do they go?
Some of them go to LaGrange, some of them go to Harmony, and some of them go to Buckner.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, if there are no further questions, then we'll move on into the vote. We have a motion on the floor for approval of the figures recommended by the school board. Can we do this by voice vote? Or
yes.
Okay, so we'll go with a voice vote on this. All in favor of the motion to approve the figures recommended, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign. And motion carries. Thank you, Mr.
Thanks,
Williams.
Sir.
All right. Ms. Alley.
The next item under other business is the Pond Creek subdivision clarification of a binding element. We met with the applicant and developer's attorney, and they had applied for originally was to amend the binding element, and after discussion with staff, we said it's more of a clarification of the binding element, so that's why it's going to be treated under other business today. Rather, it's not really an amendment. It's just a clarification of the binding element regarding lighting. So I'll leave it at that unless Jim wants to interject anything or just turn it over to the applicant.
All right, Mr. Club, is that you?
you, Mr. Chairman.
I just needed to disclose that I do have a business relationship with Denny Jones. He is my broker for my real estate agent, and we've also been friends for a very long time. But I don't feel that would affect if we even have to vote on this.
I'm not sure that we actually have to vote on anything here. I think it's just a clarification. There may be an acknowledgement that we understand that. There may be a vote, and I guess you can
still
either...
Still felt I should put that out there.
Any concerns? If none, then we'll move forward. Mr. Club, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Josh Club with Bramlin Club Law Office. We have an office here across the street, 206 North 2nd Street, LaGrange, Kentucky. Mr. Chairman, I'm here today representing Matt Jones Construction Company. The principal of that company is Denny Jones. He's here in attendance today to answer any questions that the commission may have. I haven't prepared a PowerPoint presentation as I typically would in a situation like this. I don't know that it really lends itself to that. I have, however, printed off several of the materials. I believe most of those materials are in the packet that was sent out to the commission members. If I may approach the chairman and provide a copy of all those materials to put in the record.
Thanks, sir. You keep these?
If I can give just a brief history, this certainly predates my practice before this body, and it may predate some of your involvements as well. Pond Creek development, section one of that development was approved originally back in around 2005, roughly. That was section one. This is a lighting issue. As to section one, there were no binding elements or restrictions put on the lighting in that section one, and those lights were originally placed. If I can move this, Amy. We call these acorn lights. This is the light that was put up in section one from when construction began, 2005-06-ish until currently. Section two came before this body for approval around September of 2000. I didn't write the last number down. Around September of 2008, I quit writing in my notes. September of 2008, several neighbors appeared at that hearing. There was concern raised about the lighting. These are neighbors over in Harmony Landing. Concerns were raised about the lighting and whether that would be continue to be the acorn lighting. During that meeting, it was suggested that full cut down lighting be used. My client will come up and tell you his understanding of that at the time was very limited. His agreement was made in haste. But nonetheless, it was made, and the binding elements, I've got a copy of those, were approved, with number 19 being part of those, which stated that full cut down lighting shall be used. So development began on section two. My client met with LG&E, who is a lighting provider, puts up lighting, I believe, most developments, certainly this one. It was discussed of what full cut down lighting meant. He was informed that there was no good option for full cut down lighting. Typically that's thought of as a shoebox light like you would see in a parking lot so that no light escapes outside the boundaries. And obviously we're trying to light up a street here. We're not trying to light up just what's under the light. But that really wasn't an option in residential lighting for a full cut down lighting. As a result of that, there's a few things at play here. There's about a 32-acre buffer between the Harmony Landing development and this development that was agreed to be not developed. It's pretty steep, wooded. My client felt that was a buffer. Additionally, when leaves are on, it's almost impossible to see the lights. So having met with LG&E, not believing there was a good option, my client probably at this point mistakenly continued with the acorn lighting that I showed earlier. First of those lights were put up in 2009, with housing being slow at the time, there were no complaints. He continued on and put up more of those lights. I believe at this point we have installed seven or eight lights. At some point, the planning staff was contacted or code enforcement that those lights were not to be used in section two. My client met with LG&E again. We've come up with a solution that we would like to present to this body today, and we hope that you all would agree that what we're proposing to do going forward meets with the spirit of what we agreed to back in 2008. The lights, if the commission approves this, the lights that are currently in Section 1, even though they're appropriate under the binding elements of Section 1, they will be removed and also replaced along with the lights already installed in Section 2 and all additional lights going forward. This is a copy. This is actually two pages. The second page actually just has some technical information. This light is actually a little bit dimmer than the acorn lighting. Another reason that the acorn lighting was continued into Section 2, if you go with a different type of light, it doesn't emit light out as far, so more lights would have to be put up. My client also thought that if they stuck with acorn lights, there would be a smaller number of those lights, and that would be preferable to adding more. But apparently that is not the case. So we're here today. This is a coach light, and obviously it has a top on the light, which prevents any light from going up. Additionally, there are shields available to install on the side of the light where you don't want light to escape. Those on the street that adjoins the neighboring development, all street lights will be placed on that side of the street, and these shields will be installed on that side of the light so that no light should escape towards the Harmony Lane development. Does that make sense? We have been in contact with not only the planning staff, the judge's office got involved, code enforcement, the neighboring landowners also had an attorney, Mr. Barry Baxter, who helped them with this matter as well. We have communicated with all parties involved on numerous occasions, and I've also, Mr. Chairman, furnished you emails from both neighbors as well as Mr. Baxter on behalf of those neighbors, indicating that they are in agreement with the lighting as proposed. They believe it meets with the spirit. I believe it's a fair statement of what those emails say. Certainly you can feel free to read them for yourself. They wanted this body to approve that and make sure it met with what you all intended the lighting to be at the time. If you have any questions for me, I'm certainly happy to answer those. I have Mr. Jones here to answer questions as well, should you have any questions for him. But basically, we would ask that this body vote to approve this light, that it meets the intent of the binding element, and that if it were installed, it would satisfy that binding element requirement. One other note, we've said all along that the lighting, that we have to kind of operate on LG&E's time frame. There are new lights scheduled to be installed at Pond Creek sometime in the summer. We would propose, if this is approved, that the existing lights, including Section 1, would be removed at that time. We plan to get it done this summer, no later than the end of 2018. We'll make every effort possible to get it done by the summer of 18. That's correct, Denny? Okay. If there's any questions, we'll be happy to answer them.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Club. Mr. Urban.
What, Josh, you said summer of 18.
I'm sorry, summer of 17.
Yes. Yes.
Sorry.
Thank you. That's summer this summer.
That was a mistake on my part.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak in support of this? Fair enough. Is there anyone present who wishes to speak in opposition to this proposal? All right, commissioners, any questions?
Chairman, if you're going to take action, I think it's simply that you accept the proposal as as compliant with the binding element that calls for a full cutoff down lighting.
Mr. Carter, anything to add?
No.
All right. Ms. Albertson.
Thank you. I had a question. I didn't understand. You said something about what side of the street the lights would be put on. Could you explain that again?
This wasn't originally my application. I do not have a copy of the plat.
Basically, Mr. Club, isn't it just one side, and it would typically be on, I think, the north side of the street? Is that a good cardinal direction?
I can do a very crude drawing. Do you have a copy of the plat?
I'm very familiar with it. I live pretty much across the street from it.
Okay. This is Pond Creek Drive. Runs right here. This is the 32-acre buffer area up here. That's the steep grade with the trees. And the landowners who had raised concern originally and who complained lived over here, okay? The lights are squares. There's four sides to them with shields. typically the street lights will be placed on every other side of the street, alternating down the street. What we're proposing to do is, instead of alternating on every other side, because we'd have to put on the, I guess this is the south side of that street, we would have to put the shields on the side of the street, so it would block all street lighting, which wouldn't make sense. So what we're proposing to do is place all the street lights on this particular street, on this northern side of the street, and then put the shields on the north side of those lights, so they don't shine in the direction of that development.
I see. Thank you. Yes, that's good explanation. Thank you.
Any other questions? All right. Being no further questions, no opposition, no closing statements, I'm going to move directly into entertaining a motion. Do we have a motion? Mr. McWilliams.
Let me digress just a moment, go back to questions. Are we approving proposed amended binding element 19? Is that the...
I believe Mr. Carter just told us that the appropriate approach would be to deem this proposal compliant.
Okay.
With the, is it binding elements,
right.
Or
yes.
With the binding elements of the...
So the proposal would be compliant with the existing binding element.
That
correct.
That it meets the spirit of that binding element and is compliant with it, yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mr. King.
All right. Further questions? If none, then we'll move into motion making. I will open the floor for a motion. Tick tock. Mr. McWilliams, is that your hand I saw?
Yes, sir, unfortunately, I guess it is.
I don't think you're going to have to fight for it.
All right. If this comes out right, it'll be divine intervention. I move to approve the proposal as presented to us this morning because this proposal is compliant with the existing binding element.
Mm-hmm. Number 19.
All right. Mm-hmm. So, we have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second, and we will do this by voice vote.
Mm-hmm. Roll call is when you
excuse me.
Call names. Voice vote is
excuse
all
me,
in
roll
favor.
Call vote. Thank okay. you, Mr. Urban.
Yep.
My natural.
Mr. Klingenfuss?
Yes.
Mr. Mesker?
Yes.
Mr. McWilliams?
Yes.
Ms. Smith?
Yes.
Ms. Albertson?
Yes.
Dr. Arvin?
Yes.
Ms. Bonet?
Yes.
Ms. Crosby?
Yes.
Mr. Falvey?
Yes.
Mr. Douglas? Oh, excuse me. Mr. Horton?
Yes.
Mr. Neal?
Yes.
So motion carries 11 none. Mr. Club, that's all we have. All right, Ms. Alvey.
All right, this is just kind of to put it into the record. We had a extension of expiration request for Norton Commons Hamlet. We only approved this. Normally, it's a two-year extension. We are in the process of reviewing the current extension of expiration policy with the study review committee. So we have only extended this extension of expiration for Norton Commons Hamlet to 6 months. So their new expiration date will be August 31st of 2017. So we're just putting that into the record so it's documented in the minutes. For the commission. The next item is the commissioner training hours. On January 24th at our last planning commission hearing meeting, we had training where we reviewed motions, questioning of applicants and staff, and then we also had an overview of the stormwater committee. And then those listed were Albertson, Arvin, Bonet, Crosby, Douglas, Falvey, Horton, King, McWilliams, Mesker, and Smith. They attended the entire training, which was 2.5 hours. Mr. Finney had to leave early, and so he only attended for an hour. So I would like to get a motion to approve those training hours for those commissioners that attended on January the 24th.
All right, commissioners, can we get a motion, Mr. McWilliams?
So moved.
He beat you to the punch.
Yeah, so moved.
Is it okay?
Yeah.
All right. Can we get a second? I think we have a motion and a second. We'll do this by voice of vote. All in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign. Motion carries. Thank you, Ms. Alvey. All right, Brooke, are you next? Okay.
No, we're going to read the first one and table that,
beg pardon.
Correct?
All right. So we need to read PZ17-001. Ethel, can you take care of that for us, please?
Application has been filed by City of LaGrange for the approval of a zoning map amendment on approximately 19 acres. The properties are located South Highway 53 and Pine Ridge Road in LaGrange. The change is from R2 Residential to C3 General Business District and R4 Residential.
Okay, Ms. Alvey.
The original agenda that you received with your packet had a note beside it that said that that had been withdrawn. I received an email. An email from the mayor on the mayor of LaGrange on February 22nd regarding Shannon Acres' application, which is that docket, that 17001, that said, Amy, please accept this notice as the city's intention to proceed with the application at a later date. We do not want to withdraw the application. So since it had already been docketed, and then we would just have made record of it that it would have been withdrawn. I'm assuming, Mr. Carter, that since they don't want to withdraw, that they will just have to make a motion to table it?
Yes.
Okay. And it'll be brought back before the commission at a later date.
All right, so applicant wishes to table. Can I get a motion on the floor to table this before you make that? Understand that it is non-debatable, comes to an immediate vote. But if the applicant is wishing to table, then we'll follow that course. Mr. Horton.
Motion then to table the docket PZ17-001.
We have a motion. Do we have a second? Okay, we have a motion and a second. Again, voice vote okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right. All in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, like sign. Motion carries. Thank you, Ms. Alvey. All right. Next item of business, PZ17-002. Ethel, can you please read this one into the docket?
Docket PZ17-002. Application has been filed by Mary Vanderburg for the approval of a zoning map amendment on approximately 2.18 acres. The property is located at the 4800 block of Sadler's Mill Road in Buckner. The change is from R2A Residential to R4 Residential. And docket PZ17-003, application has been filed by Mary Vanderburg for the approval of a preliminary plan on approximately 2.18 acres. The property is located at the 4800 block of Sadler's Mill Road in Buckner. The proposed zoning is R4 Residential.
All right, Brooke, this
Mr.
is yours.
Mr. Chairman, before I begin, would you want to outline the procedure for the public just so they understand?
Certainly, certainly. So procedure for hearing applications runs in a limited and balanced structure. The introduction by the staff occurs first with 20 minutes allocated. Presentation by applicant follows with testimony and questions by those opposing the application following that. Each of the applicant and opposition time blocks are equally allocated to 50 minutes. After presentation and testimony from those two groups occurs, then we have questions from the commission. Thereafter, we move into rebuttal evidence, again, from the applicant and opposition, and then final statements. Then the commission moves into a consideration of the question. So we'll begin with, in this connection, the presentation from the staff.
Okay, good morning. Brooke Veeman. I'm the planner with Oldham County Planning and Development Services. As Ms. Fox stated, the applicant is requesting approval of a zoning map amendment from R2A to R4. as well as approval of a preliminary plan, including 10 condo units. The proposal is located at the 4800 block of Sadler's Mill Road in Buckner. As stated, the existing zoning is R2A residential and the proposed zoning is R4 residential. The property is 2.1 acres in totality. This is an aerial view of the site. This, again, as a reminder, is a 2012 flyover, so there have since been some changes and building on lots that are located in the neighborhood surrounding it. And you can see it's located off Sadler's Mill Road, which is also located off Highway 393, directly across from the Oldham County Country Club. And this is just a zoomed-in view of the site in question. This is the future land use map. It was adopted in 2014 with the adoption of the comprehensive plan. It, based on trends and current standards, it predicts what the land uses of the future will be. The prediction for this particular site was single-family residential. And this is the current zoning. As you can see, the site in question is zoned R2A. The map is incorrect in that it has part of it as yellow, which is R2, but it is in fact zoned completely R2A. You can see that R2 exists to the north and the south, along with R1 to the west, and R2 to the east, and R2A to the east as well. It's bounded by multiple single-family neighborhoods, including Morgan Place, Kamer Place, and Heather Hill. And I just wanted to review the case history with you. This is a zoning map amendment, so adjoining properties within 500 feet were notified. There were 55 mailings that went out to adjoining properties, and that includes TRC and this Planning Commission mailing. There was a sign posted to the property on February 14th of 2017. And the public notice appeared in the Oldham Era. So everything complies with KRS 100 and Chapter 424. So we'll go through the proposed development plan. There are two 11,840 square foot buildings. Both are comprised of five attached condo units each. And I wanted to compare the existing allowable density and the proposed density of each zoning classification. The maximum density in R2A, which is the existing zoning classification, is 5.81 dwelling units per acre. So since it's 2.18 acres, the permitted density in this area would be approximately 13 homes permitted. That's without adding infrastructure and roads and everything else. So probably wouldn't be able to fit 13, but according to our zoning regulations, it does allow that. The maximum density in R4 is 16 dwelling units per acre. Therefore, this site would allow up to 35 units if the zoning is approved. However, the applicant is only proposing a total of 10 units. So this is the proposed development or preliminary plan. You can see the property line is circled in red. The proposed buildings are 65 feet from the rear property line and 62 feet from the front property line. On the western property line, it's 29 feet from the side, and then the western is 47 and eastern is 29 feet. Each 1,588 square foot unit will have two bedrooms and a 750 square foot garage in addition. Each unit will have a two-car wide driveway located off the private drive, bringing the parking total to 4 spaces per condo unit, or 40 spaces total, and that meets our minimum parking standards. Just wanted to outline for you the attached two-car garage located inside of the unit, and again, the driveway that serves each individual unit. There's a 20-foot landscape buffer area on the rear property line along with both sides of the property, and a 10-foot vehicular use area landscape buffer on the front property line. And those meet the standards of our landscape regulations. There's 26,600 square feet of open space proposed in the rear of the property that abuts Golf View Court, which is the Morgan Place subdivision. according to our property development regulations for R4, they exceed that standard because the minimum based on this lot size and the amount of units proposed is 2,500 square feet of open space. So I just wanted to outline for you where the landscape buffers will be located. You can see the landscape buffers outlined in green and the open space outlined in blue. These are the proposed building elevations. The bottom one is a rendering, and the top was a colored rendering that was provided after I sent out your packets. This shows the rear elevations. There was the elevations that were sent to you in your packet that were submitted on January 25th have since been revised based on comments that they've heard from adjoining properties and from staff. And the revised building elevations are the bottom. And those were submitted on February 23rd. So I'll let the applicant give you more of an explanation, but I just wanted to show you the difference between the walkout and just the one, the single story. So we'll go through some of the site pictures. This is the north view, and this is looking onto the site of 4800 block of Sadler's Mill Road. You can see the zoning change sign posted there. All of those homes that you see in the photo are on Gulfview Court, which are part of Morgan Place subdivision. This is the northwest view. It's looking towards the access easement for the water tower, which runs along the side of that property line. And the west view, running along Sadler's Mill Road, looking towards Heather Hill subdivision and Kamer Place. Again, just another view of Sadler's Mill Road that runs into Heather Hill and serves Kamer Place. And this is the northeast view. Again, you're looking into the property, but at the rear of the property, you can see that there are existing single-family homes from Gulfview subdivision, and then an adjoining property owner that's served from Sadler's Mill Road to the east. And this is just a better view of the adjoining property to the east, which is 4801 Sadler's Mill Road. There's an aerial shot at the bottom of the screen to help orient you to show you where exactly this adjoining property is located. And this is the east view on Sadler's Mill Road, looking back towards the intersection of Sadler's Mill and 393. This is the access easement for Oldham County Water. It is on the western side of the proposed development. And these, I'm actually standing in this picture. I'm standing at the cul-de-sac of Gulfview, and I'm looking back into the site of the proposed development, which is really kind of in this area. I don't know if you can see that black mark. That's the best shot I could get from not walking onto someone's property, but you can just kind of get an idea of what they'd be looking at from their homes. And those are circled in blue on your aerial map. So in summary, docket PZ17002, the applicant is requesting approval for a zoning map amendment on 2.18 acres. The proposed change is from R2A residential to R4 residential. So as you know, you'll be making a recommendation for approval or denial to Oldham County Fiscal Court, who makes the final decision on this zoning map amendment. And then docket PZ17003, the applicant is requesting approval of a preliminary plan for the construction of 10 condo units. And you will make a decision on the preliminary plan today. That's all that I have.
Thank you, Brooke. Mr. Urban.
One addition. No traffic study was required for this development. It didn't trip our requirements for traffic study, so that's why Paula is not here, our traffic consultant. And the county engineer is in training today, so he's not here, but his comments are included in the binding elements. So just for the record, that's why we don't have additional staff here.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Urban. All right. And we'll move into presentation by the applicant. Mr. Club, is that you?
Sir.
Very good. All right.
You didn't get questions.
Oh, excuse me. You want to have some questions for Brooke first? I'm sorry, Mr. Club. Let's.
Yeah,
Mr.
one question. for Ms. Veman and staff. Could you clarify for me exactly what it means in the R2A residential district under the intent? It says detached single family and attached two family areas, but over in the permitted use, it says dwellings only, single family detached. It doesn't mention condos or multifamily attached units. Can someone help me with that, or council, or all of you, to?
R2A, I'm sorry to interrupt you. R2A does not allow for attached single family dwellings. That is why, even though they're meeting the density requirement, they have to, in order to propose condo units, apply for the R4 residential district zoning classification, because R4 does allow multifamily along with single family attached.
Okay, so it is as specific as it's written.
Correct.
Then.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Albertson.
I have a question concerning that also. not part of this question, but am I correct in reading it that the R2A allows single detached and attached two family? That's under the first column over there.
Under the intent?
Well, let me say, permitted uses is really what your category is. The intent really is not enforceable as a rule or law. The intent just describes what that district is all about. You have to look at the permitted uses, and under the permitted uses, residential dwellings, single family, detached. That's the only thing that's allowed in the R2A.
And attached two family. Right, in the part of the same sentence, and attached two family areas.
I'm not sure where you're getting that. There's accessory.
Right.
Yeah, you're reading the intent. Again, the intent is not what's permitted. The intent is a description of the district.
I think, and you updated.
Yeah, you might have the old version.
Okay.
When we went through the study review committee and we went through all the revisions to date of the update of the zoning ordinance, we clarified that and took that out because, again, in
and
the...
Did everybody get a copy of the new?
Well, they were, you know, we've always had those online, and we probably need to print you a copy.
It's not on the... This is part of the what has gone through the study review committee and went to the fiscal court and all the legislative bodies. The whole document will be recreated once the second section of the comprehensive zoning ordinance is created. So what you have in your book, you should have, when the Planning Commission approved those or recommended those changes to the Planning Commission, you should have kept that stack of information, because that's where the accessory dwelling units, if you look and see, this is the updated one, because the old version doesn't identify the accessory dwelling units, and that was approved. Yeah. By the legislative bodies. And so this is where we cleaned up the language on the intent, the permitted uses, and conditional uses on there. So what you have and what you have still in your old book, which is not correct, is where you're getting where it says detached and attached two family areas.
If you look at permitted uses, you can see here under residential, it says dwelling single family detached. So the reason we went back and revised this is because those two, the intent that says attached two family areas and the permitted uses were in conflict with one another. So what we did is we just went in as part of that revision and removed that conflict.
All right.
That's how we've always reviewed R2A. We've never, in my understanding, allowed attached single family units. It was just really a mistake in the intent. We always follow what the permitted uses state, which only at that time and at this time allow single family detached units, which is located, if you can see,
and right, even if you were to apply the two family, their proposal is not two family.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
That's why they're changing the zoning, and that's why there's a zoning map amendment request.
It's a good question, though. Thank you for bringing that.
Yeah. I would suggest request that if, I mean, I've saved everything in the world we've gotten.
Mm-hmm.
that if there is something like what we have today with a zoning change request, that if, since there is a newer version, that be included in our packets, because we're dealing with mm-hmm. obsolete information here.
Sure, understood.
I'm sorry about that. I will make sure that happens in the future.
Can you highlight what it should be up there, make it larger so we can see?
Let's see if I can zoom in somehow.
That would be under the permitted uses, I guess.
That better? You see it a little bit better?
Yes, much better.
So the new intent for R2A, which has been adopted by the Planning Commission and the legislative bodies, states the purpose of R2A residential district is to allow, preserve, and protect the character of low to medium density detached single family and neighborhoods at densities ranging from one dwelling unit per acre up to 5.8 dwelling units per acre. So the only thing that changed in that section was the portion that read detached single-family units and what was it? Attached two-family.
Two-family.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Because that was in conflict with what we were what was in the permitted usage, which was detached single-family dwellings.
All right.
Mr. Horton.
Just one quick question to follow up on this. Do you have any projected time that the commission could anticipate when all this is finalized? And we'll have it into a book.
We're working on, as you know, with study review committee, we're working on phase two of the revision, but we're revising the entirety of the whole document, which, as you know, takes quite a while to get through. And staff is still trying to work through the best way to provide those materials to both the Planning Commission, the boards, and the public. Right now, it's available on our website, the newer version, but we don't want to print the new books because they're going to eventually change, and it's not the entire document that's being revised.
I thought I'd bring that up just so those who aren't on the SRC and so forth might get some sense of where we are, and that is in the middle of everything.
I wouldn't even say we're in the middle. I think we still
we're approaching the middle of everything.
Somewhere near the middle.
A fourth of the way, maybe.
Yeah, and Ms. Albertson's comment is good. You know, in our staff reports, from now on, we'll make sure that we point that out for the commission especially.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Further questions? All right. Being none, then we'll move into presentation from the applicant. Mr. Club, you're up. Before you get started, if you have anyone who will be giving testimony, we'd like to go ahead and get them sworn in.
Chairman, I have five people here that may be giving testimony. There may be some others that wish to speak in favor. I'm not sure how you want them to all stand at once.
Those on your team, I'd like to go ahead and get sworn.
Anybody's going to speak in favor, potentially, and certainly my applicants. Are you going to be sworn in as well, please?
Raise your hand, please. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Thank you, Mr. Club.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Josh Club, 206 North 2nd Street in LaGrange, Kentucky. Thank you, Brooke, for the staff report. As usual, I'll be repeating a little bit, but hopefully not much. As some of you may have noticed if you reviewed your packet prior to the meeting, and I've given him credit here, Mr. Baxter actually represents Ms. Vandenbark. The application is correct in all respects. Mr. Baxter did a very good job of putting that together. However, he mentioned in that application that this was affordable housing, which I believe was rather unfortunate because I think it connotes things that are less than desirable. So because of that, Ms. Vandenbark paid for him to go to Florida today, so he didn't make any more misstatements about what this is to get people upset. So I'm joking. He had a vacation planned for today with his wife and family, so he asked that I stand in today. So that's why I'm here today. We are here today to ask this body to recommend to the legislative body a zone change from R2A to R4. Back to the comment that I just made about the application stating this was an affordable housing project. I realize, and I think looking back, we realize that does connote some negative things. However, I believe from reviewing this application with my clients And reviewing the available options, we believe that the product we're proposing for Oldham County today, which you'll see through this application, is as nice of a product of a patio home as there is located in this county. Based on the construction materials, the design, the interior amenities, as well as the location, we feel that it is going to be a first-rate product, as well as a market analysis and the price per square foot that you're going to hear about today. We feel this is a premier product for Oldham County. It means no disrespect to any other projects such as this in the county. There are certainly some nice ones out there. There probably are some on par with this, but we don't feel there's anything nicer. Moving on, we are seeking the zone change. It's a 2.18-acre tract on Sadler's Mill Road. We are seeking to go from an R2A to an R4. My estimation was apparently wrong. I estimate to be approximately in the 5,000 block of Sadler's Mill Road. Ms. Veeman stated 4,800. She's probably correct. I believe the last address that I saw headed up Sadler's Mill Road was 4,800. But it's in that vicinity. There has been no address assigned yet. The development, when completed, would be called Golf View Patio Homes. Obviously, this sits directly across the street from the Oldham County Country Club. And it would be our intent that people, many retirees would like to own a unit here. Hopefully some of them will like to play golf, and that's certainly part of the play on the name as well as the location of this project. Mary Vandenbark is the applicant. She's here today. She'll be speaking in just a minute. I'll call her up. And this project she is doing in conjunction with Tim Menard Construction Company. Tim is also here. Will be the builder. He's a partner in this. There will be an LLC formed down the road, but the two of them are teaming up with their spouses to complete this project. Again, we feel this will be an upscale patio home development, providing 10 units in two buildings. Each of those will contain 5 units. Current site is vacant land. Ms. Veeman showed you the pictures of the surrounding area. It goes without saying, on two sides there are single family residential uses. On the third side, there's actually the easement that goes back to the Oldham County Water District. They have a rather large tank back there. If you're in the area, it kind of sticks out. It's kind of a landmark there. And on the fourth side, which is probably the greatest adjoining side, is the Oldham County Country Club that will lie directly across the street. We feel that the scale and use of this project, both in the square footage and the price, as well as the use and the type of people who will live in this community, will be compatible with the surrounding area and the existing uses. And this area is also served currently by necessary community facilities, water, sewer, electric, those type things. Those provisions have all been made by our engineer, Mr. Bill Berry, who's also here today to speak if you have any questions. We feel that this development meets with the goals and objectives of the Oldham County Comprehensive Plan. Obviously, we've heard today from the school, and Mr. Urban has, in his initial report, stated that Oldham County continues to grow. Buckner area, this area in particular, also continues to grow, and with that growth comes a need of varied quality housing. Not everybody is looking for a single family house with a large yard, or even a yard for that matter, to maintain, and certainly this development will meet that need. We actually have had residents from the adjoining developments show up at our neighborhood meeting. They've actually approached my clients about purchasing some of these units should this body recommend the zone change and should they be built. So we have people that are already in the area who are there. I believe some of them actually may be in the audience today. Hopefully they'll speak up and let you know that they're interested in these properties as well. There is a limited availability of patio homes of this this type in the area. Back to my previous comment, actually the applicant has already has commitments from 5 people to purchase 5 of the 10 units. So it's not like we're building a product without a market. We feel that this is something that will sell if it is approved and built. It is infill development. This is currently vacant land. As you saw, there's really nothing else around here that hasn't been developed. I believe if you go back in the history of this track, the Morgan Place development directly behind it, the owners, the developers of that particular development are actually the owners of this tract now, which we have an option to purchase. And we feel the demand will be high for this type of housing, given its proximity to the golf course as well as Wendelmore Park, and it's also centrally located in a nice area of the county. Ms. Veeman already stated this, but the current zoning of R2A allows 5.8 dwelling units per acre. Approximately 12.66 was the number she cited That's how many dwelling units we could put on this property as it currently exists without ever seeking a zone change. Granted, if you were to approve an R4 zone change, that density would increase to 16 dwelling units or a little over 32 dwelling units for the entire site. However, that is not what we're proposing. In conjunction with our zone change application, we have a preliminary development plan which will cap the maximum number of dwelling units that this property would ever see, and that would be at 10 units in the 2 5-unit buildings, so that we would actually be 2.5 to 3 units under what's already permissible, and there will be no more building on this property for numerous reasons, not the least of which is if it's built as proposed, there'd be no more room. Additionally, by putting 10 units in 2 buildings, the impervious surfaces we feel would be limited, as opposed to putting up even 10 single-family residents with the longer driveways, the additional streets, and the additional roofs that would be required for 10 separate units. We feel that the impervious surfaces would be lessened, which I know is something the county's concerned about in preventing or slowing down that runoff. So we feel that it meets that requirement as well. At this point, I'd like to bring up Mary Vandenbark, the applicant, to put on some testimony. Ms. Vandenbark, if you want to come on up.
Ms. Vandenbark, we need to get your name and address for the record, please.
Yes. Mary Vandenbark, 1060 Bluegrass Parkway, LaGrange, Kentucky.
Okay, please proceed.
Ms. Vandenbark, you are the applicant in this project, is that correct?
I am.
And you're doing this on your own, or is this in conjunction with somebody else?
It's in conjunction with Tim Menard and my husband and his wife. This is all depending on the rezoning change. Tim Menard has a pending purchase of the land. This is pending based on the rezoning. And once it's once we get the approval.
Can you speak up a little bit? There's fans on and I'm not sure everybody can hear. I know it's hard to project, but.
Okay. The purchase of the land is pending upon rezoning of this property.
Okay. If this zoning were to go through and approvals were to be given timely, when would you anticipate the construction would start?
We're hoping to start this summer, June, once we get through these proceedings, and we expect an 8 to 9 month building process.
So by spring of next year, approximately a year from now, if all things
yes.
go well, you would hope that these units would be selling and some of them would be occupied by that point.
Yes, we're hoping to build both sections at the same time to alleviate the long process of building one and then the other. So get construction, get the roads in quickly to eliminate the construction that might fall through around the areas to eliminate that time for our neighbors' ease of getting through.
Okay. Mary, what would be the estimated sales price? What do you all estimate that these units will sell for each?
Based on the market analysis of the areas and what patio homes typically do, these are maintenance-free patio homes as well. We estimate it from $275 to $285.
So the total project value that would go on the tax rolls here in Oldham County would be approximately $2.8 million. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. What would be the average price per square foot of these units?
Approximately $167 square foot.
All right. And have you done a market analysis of properties in the neighborhood, both single family and some multifamily or smaller developments in the area?
We've had a licensed real estate agent prepare us a sales analysis of the Morgan Place subdivision, which would be the subdivision that goes directly behind the Gulf View patio homes, and also Heather Hills, which has been there for years. We've also done, had her do a sales analysis of some patio homes that are in the Buckner area they're within a mile or two of these patio homes, so we could kind of gear what the market is for patio homes. And that's where we feel this would be.
And just so we're clear, which development is that?
That is the Cedar Point condos off of Cedar Point Road and Highway 146.
Okay. Based upon your review of those market analysis, what would the price per square foot of this development be with the three you just mentioned?
$167 approximately.
Compared to those others, though, would it be at or greater than the average?
Greater than. It's at the definitely top end, Cedar Point. As far as Heather Hills, it's in the Heather Hills ranges. It's got a pretty big range, and Morgan Place has even bigger range. But we are definitely at the upper quadrant of the square foot the price per square foot.
Okay. Let's talk a little bit about the features these are going to have. if you can, I've got a few slides here. Feel free to look at those. The commissioners can see that as well. Tell me what these units are going to be like.
These units will be completely brick, front, side, back, all brick. They will have a, they will not be walkouts as originally submitted. We have determined based on the view from the back as well as the lay of the land that we will not be doing walkouts. They will have full basements, however. They will also have a window well, so there will be ability for additional space in the basements for purchasing these. We will custom build the basements as needed, so these properties could very well exceed $275,000 depending on the upgrades that each individual buyer chooses.
Mary, the 167 number we just talked about, that's based upon the first floor finished out, unfinished basement, is that correct?
Yes, that is above grade only, and all of our sales analysis was also done above grade only to determine what the price per square foot is.
As far as parking goes, do you anticipate there being any over parking or overflow parking on Sadler's Mill Road?
No, one nice thing about this development, and I used to live in Kamer Place, so I took Sadler Mill Road a lot. So I understand it is a thin, skinny road. So the way this works out, this is going to actually be on its own private road. There's one entrance into this development, and then it has its own private road where all the driveways are. So there's one way in, one way out, so you won't have 10 extra driveways on Sadler Mill Road. So this should not and will not create some kind of traffic issue in that area. So in within the private road, each home will have a two-car garage, and they will have their own driveway. So they have a potential of four cars per home.
Off the private street.
Off of the private street. Now, if they were to have guests, there will be the ability to have short-term parking outside of those homes on a private street. There will absolutely be no parking on Sadler's Mill Road.
Okay. As I alluded to earlier, I think that some of the neighbors had concerns about this being quote-unquote affordable housing and what that might connote. As far as a lower-end project, that's not your desire at all, correct?
It absolutely is not our desire to have a lower-end project. Like we said, the building materials will be of the highest quality. It will also be a deed-restricted property that will have a homeowners association that will handle all the outside maintenance. They also will handle snow removal. There will be, such things as there will be no RVs parked in the driveway, no boats, no trailers, things of that sort to keep the property neat, clean, and kept to the value that it's going to be built. We also will not allow, and it will be in the deed, there will not be rentals allowed. Only the people that are deeded to own these properties will be able to live in these properties or their immediate family, such as a mother or a father, something of that sort, because these are geared towards the retired person. Not to say that a younger person might not want it, but these are geared towards the retired person that enjoys golf.
Okay. Some of the interior features that what you're telling them.
Yeah, these the interior is going to be of high quality hardwood floors, custom cabinetry. There will be granite countertops not only in the kitchen but in the bathroom. Professionally landscaped, we have a landscape plan already prepared, preliminary based on how everything goes, but Greenscapes Inc. has been kind enough to go ahead and draw that up for us to show where the larger trees will be. So it'll also be maintained. All the landscape will be maintained by the funds that the Homeowners Association assesses.
Okay. We have a color architectural rendering of what one of the buildings is proposed to look like. Is that a fair depiction of that?
Yeah, you can see the kind of the two-car garages. The brick actually goes around over the garages. You see the entryway and the gables over the garage and the front door.
So these are the drive. This is the private drive in front that runs horizontally across that page, and then the private drives with a landscaped yard in front of each entrance. Is that a fair statement?
That is correct.
And in addition to being all brick, these will be maintenance-free units.
Yes, exterior maintenance-free.
Exterior maintenance-free. This is the side. and rear elevations of the building as proposed. Is that correct?
Yes, there could be some modification to the lower rear elevation picture. We, after looking at the design and some of the comments that we've got, we'd like to probably put gables on the doorways. That is something that will be drawn in if the design process gets to that point. But that's merely an aesthetic thing and not necessary.
Mayor, if we can talk about this, I know this is actually a rendering that's changed since the one that went out in the packet that went out to the commissioners. You stated earlier that a couple of reasons, but also you got some feedback from community members that it appeared to be rather large in the rear of this, and it was a bit overwhelming for the neighbors to the rear. Is that another reason that you decided to go with, in addition to the one stated, that you decided to go with this design as opposed to the one that you had originally submitted?
Yes, the rendering that went out did not fully give the view of what it was going to look like. It didn't have the deck or the deck railings. It didn't have the gables. It didn't have the porch or the landscaping. So it looked, and I have to admit, it looked very boxy. And we did get some feedback. They didn't like that. It looked too big. It looked like a wall type thing. So after we got together with our builder and our engineer, we decided that we would just make this a non-walkout, so our buyers still have the basement to enjoy for the space, but they don't have the walkout capabilities anymore. So we thought this would appease the people, the five homes that will be looking into this on a regular basis.
Were there any other concerns that were raised at the neighborhood meeting?
The only neighborhood comments that I can remember, we only had, I think, six from the neighborhood that came, and we had two actually potential buyers that came to the meeting, was basically at that point, the look of it was probably the biggest question, and then since then, a lot of questions about traffic, but we've already determined that traffic is not of an issue.
Also had a landscape plan prepared, and I apologize to the commission about the shadow of Mr. Menard. That was the best copy that he could get us yesterday at 3 o'clock or so. But
right.
If you can please describe that landscape plan, I hope the commissioners can see.
Right,
that.
This is it's hard to see from the angle, but if you've seen a landscape plan, this is kind of how they draw it. You'll see the circles, and in the circles you'll see references with boxes of you'll see like up here. That shows the type of tree that's going to be planted in those three gray circles along the way. Those are some form of pine, spruce type, fast-growing trees.
I'm sorry.
Can't hear me.
Make sure and speak up.
I'm sorry.
In addition to this.
Okay. Okay. So you can see that there's different types of trees going to be planted in different parts of the project. The back will be fast-growing as well as in the big orange circles you can see. Those are actually colorful trees to add some color to the background. You'll see the little dots on the right side. Those are actually blooming bushes. You'll see more color on the left, and in the front you'll see some other types of trees. This is a professional licensed landscaper that looks at the lay of the land as well as the root systems to make sure that we're planting the right thing for the right type of areas.
Okay. And again, the company that you're going to be contracting with to do that?
Greenscapes, Inc.
Okay. Mary, I believe that's all the questions I have for you. If we could get Mr. Berry up here to answer questions about the engineering.
Did they have questions for me, or did they ask them later?
Probably ask them right after. We'll
come to that after we get through the testimony phase.
Good morning. Let me ask everybody, can you hear me?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I'm proud of myself that years ago I was said I had the maximum
Mary,
number.
Mr. Berry, before you go, let me get your name and address for the record, please.
I'm sorry, Bill Berry. 2009 Montford Circle, Crestwood.
Thank you. Please proceed.
Okay. Well, let's go to the site. You know, we've got a everything that I'm going to say or could say has probably been said. So we've got a 2.18 acre site with two buildings on it that have been engineered to fit on the site. I might point out, just for people who are concerned about our private road, that we have a note on here that would be in the binding elements, that this track, our private road, will not be ever put in the county road system. So it's going to have to be maintained by the owners in the homeowners association. This site pretty much was simple in one respect, that all the water drains not towards any existing property other when it goes down to the natural swale and ditch that goes on through the western part of the site.
And that would be located approximately here?
More like here.
Okay.
Right through there.
Right through here?
Yeah, right. Now what have you done? I didn't touch it. Or did I?
Yeah, maybe I did.
Excuse me. There's a keyboard here. Okay, looks like we're back pretty close. On the western end of the property, we've designed a detention basin to carry the, withhold the water from the site. I might add that the total drainage area of this thing is over six acres, which includes a portion of the subdivision to the north, which is, what is that?
Morgan Place,
right. And we're adding within our, within the 6 acres is our 2.18.
Mr. President, as to that retention basin, have you done the calculations on it? It's properly sized?
According to what the specifications are in the latest proposals from the county, are the last
ordinances.
I have a trouble remembering the word ordinance.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, if you get my age, you remember, get a lot of things. So anyway,
have you met with the county engineer and he concurs that there's?
We have discussed this on the phone.
Okay.
He's been a hard guy to track down. He hadn't been on the job that long.
Sure.
So that's the situation, you know, on that. And we've got one, and like it was before, we have one entrance, so there won't be a lot of entrances for anybody to be concerned with. There's one entrance, one exit. Come in, go out, turn around, come out, you know.
Utilities are available and provided for on this preliminary development plan?
Sewer's available, electric, gas, water. Of course, we've got a pretty good supply of water. The tank's right there within about 600 feet, so I think the water pressure ought to be adequate.
Is there anything else you need to add, Mr. Berry?
I don't think so.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I believe that is our last slide, and that concludes the applicant's presentation.
Very well. Thank you, Mr. Club. All right. Is anyone else here present interested in speaking on behalf of this application? Anyone present on behalf of this application?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Get anybody else sworn in? Not part of the applicant.
We're going to need to get you sworn in, and I would ask that anyone else who wishes to provide testimony of any sort, please stand at this time. We'll also get you sworn in.
In favor.
In favor. Thank you. In favor. And we'll get you sworn in. All right, please.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
And your name and address for the record, please.
It's Nita Perkins. I live in Morgan Place, right near this empty lots or property. And I have lived in Heather Hill, and I moved down to Kamer Place, and I'm over in Morgan Place, and I plan on moving to the patio homes. I like to move. I don't see any objection, especially on the road thing. I knew it's not too big of a problem, but I have lived those three subdivisions, and there is never, never, unless an ambulance comes through or a house fire back in there, that there's any problem with traffic. I'd never see anybody backing up, even with the school buses going through. The traffic is no problem there. I really think we need it in Oldham County, the patio homes. They're beautiful homes, and of course, I'm going to live in one, and I back up to the water tower. so I know you. It will take away their view a little bit, but like I told them one time, that property's out there for sale. The owner of it wants to sell it. He's not going to keep it so you can see the golf course. If you want to see the golf course, you should move up to Heather Hill. Other than that, I think it's a beautiful patio homes, and it's valued at the same, just about what I built my home for. So I don't need the grass cutting and everything, so I'm going to move down there. So I think it's very good. And besides, it's my son that's building it, so that makes a little bit of difference, too. And he's a very good builder, one of the tops in Oldham County.
Thank you. Anything else to add?
No, thank you.
All right, thank you, ma'am. Anyone else wishing to speak in favor of this application? All right, there being none, we'll move into presentation and testimony by those opposed to this application. Can we reset that clock, please?
Good morning, Mr. Commissioner.
Good morning. Before you begin, for all of those who may be preparing to provide testimony in opposition to this application, I'd like for you to go ahead and stand now so we can get you sworn in. We'll collect your names and addresses as you approach the podium.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
Please proceed.
Mr. Commissioner, I've...
Name and address for the record, please.
Nathan Merrill, 4705 Sadler's Mill Road. I've taken the liberty of providing a couple packets for the board members. If I could present those to them, might help guide them in the decision. There's two each. Brooke, can I borrow the piece of paper that you have?
That suffice?
That's it, okay. Yes. Okay. This is the new one, right?
Yes.
Okay. Just before I get started, to follow up on what Brooke was saying earlier, I was on the Oldham County Planning and Zoning website just 2 days ago, and it still had this particular R2A specified as two-family dwellings. So there might be some confusion, and I know that the applicant stated in her application that this was... the way it was zoned was already specific to two-family dwellings as well. So there might be some confusion there. But also, the way that this is written, if you remember when she was giving her presentation, there are six single-family homes on this road, and then, of course, the vacant property in question. One of those particular properties is only 0.48 acres. But as you can tell, in that zoning that up here is that particular zoning is for between 1 to 5.8 acres. And so there's a bit of a conflict there, and that's Mr. Wesley Husband's house. It's right next to this proposed development. So I wouldn't even know that that would fall into this particular zoning. Nevertheless, I'd like to get started. Thank you for allowing me to speak today. As members of Planning and Zoning Board, you're tasked with oversight of balanced yet progressive growth, ranging from commerce to housing, including the infrastructure which supports such development. Oftentimes, your decision affects large amounts of individuals' daily lives, and the proposal before you today is no different. I've come before you today as a concerned resident. I live on Sadler's Mill Road, just down from the vacant property in question. As many on the board are well aware, this area is a suburban part of Oldham County, comprised of Heather Hills, Kamer Place, and Morgan Place neighborhoods, including six additional properties located directly on Sadler's Mill Road. All properties within these neighborhoods are single-family homes. There are no multi-family complexes within this particular area. I have taken the liberty in providing you with a list of homes recently sold over the last 12 months to give the board an idea of the square footage, number of bedrooms and bathrooms, the lot size, and the value on the of the properties for these communities for review. Also included, now these are MLS listings, so included in there are the price per square foot of above grade square footage. The applicant's proposed development provides for multifamily use, adding as many as 40 additional parking spaces. This parking would further add to an already excessively traveled right-of-way. Sadler's Mill Road is the main artery servicing Heather Hills and Kamer Place subdivisions, providing access to 231 single-family homes. A road comprised of two blind hills and one 90-degree blind turn in a stretch roughly one-half of a mile long. A road providing access for all maintenance personnel and many club members wishing to house their golf carts at the Oldham County Country Club. A road boasting a ditch to one side and no shoulder on either side. A road so narrow and unsafe, with vehicles regularly speeding, endangering those who choose to walk, jog, or bike in recreation. Sadler's Mill Road is just not equipped for the additional traffic this proposed development would bring. The applicant states that the existing zoning classification is inappropriate and that the proposed zoning classification is appropriate. I cannot disagree anymore. The existing zoning for R2A would provide for custom high-end single-family homes on large lots as predefined by the county years ago and what currently exists today. Not two-bedroom, 1,588 square foot multifamily units. Goal LU1 of the comprehensive plan for Oldham County is to provide for planned and orderly growth in order to protect land from premature or unsuitable development, with the objective of ensuring that future land uses are compatible with surrounding land uses. While the applicant is proposing residential use, the way she is seeking to achieve this would be considered non-compatible, given the large amount of low-density dwellings and lack of high-density multifamily complexes in the immediate area. The intent of the proposed R4 zoning request, as spelled out under the Oldham County Comprehensive Zoning Ordinance, is to allow higher density residential uses and low intensity non-residential uses in locations with adequate infrastructure while maintaining the unique character of neighborhoods. High density of residential uses would not be in keeping of the unique character of the surrounding neighborhoods of this area. Instead, as the applicant points out herself, the current zoning of R2A would allow for attached two-family dwellings, and I know, but this is what was on the internet, would allow for attached two-family dwellings in a zoning classification specifically designed for low to medium density dwellings. The current zoning would afford the applicant to construct single-family or two-family maintenance-free living similar to Cedar Point Village if she chooses without the need to rezone. And Cedar Point Village does have single-family residences that are maintenance-free. So you don't actually have to build a condo or patio home to achieve that maintenance-free living. You just have to have an HOA buying into a master insurance plan. That's really all you need. Independent action was taken to notify residents of the zoning change and development of this as the applicant, where required by Kentucky Revised Statute, notified just 55 property owners. However, the impact of this project extends far beyond those given the courtesy of notification. A petition was started opposing the applicant's planned development, and to date has garnered 231 signatures of individuals, 231 signatures of individuals residing in the affected community. Of the 76 comments submitted, many focus on traffic as a major concern. I've provided you a copy of the petition, including comments, and would like to read just a few from the list. Scott Moore writes...
Mr. Merrill, one minute, please. Mr. Carter, with respect to petition comments, is that something that the commission can entertain?
If they can accept the petition, it can entertain a reading of what's in the petition.
You have the petition before
Thank you. Proceed.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I would just like to object for the record. I apologize, Mr. Brown. Object for the record. I can't cross-examine. If you take the petition on its face, many of them have no addresses. Some addresses are even out of state. If you take it on its face, the applicant objects to the admission of the petition. I don't believe it's proper in the proceeding, and certainly you have your own counsel rely on his advice. But we can't cross-examine. It's not verifiable, and by, on its face, many of the people don't even live in the area.
Mr. Carter?
I would object to that, as I don't know how you could say that there's many of them don't.
I think the commission can accept a petition for whatever reason it chooses to, whatever weight it chooses to give the petition.
Thank you, Mr. Carter. Proceed.
Scott Moore writes, no to any multifamily housing in our neighborhood. We choose this neighborhood because of the beautiful single-family homes. Catherine Marie Miller writes, the proposed zoning map amendment and preliminary plan for land use of a small 2.18-acre property on Sadler's Mill Road is inappropriate. The proposed plan for this land use is not consistent with neighboring residential properties. Furthermore, it generates numerous community concerns with regard to safety, property value preservation, and protecting the character of our neighborhood. It is a mistake to consider dropping these townhomes into the center of multiple neighborhoods, as the character of such high density land use is not in line with the current low density single family residential dwellings. Our community is counting on the Oldham County Planning and Development Services to carry out their mission statement to be committed to our public safety and welfare, as well as to maintain environmental integrity by stopping the rezoning and proposed development on Sadler's Mill Road. Donald Sprouse simply writes, no thanks. These comments and signatures are the voices of the people residing in this community and should be given great weight, as the applicant's proposed development would have a direct impact on their daily lives. The applicant is more than within the framework of the current zoning set classification to construct single-family or two-family homes, infilling, as she states, on this vacant land. I did want to point out a couple more things that were brought up in the process here. Specifically, no mention was given to refuse, whether we're talking about dumpsters that are sitting next to the street or we're talking about individual 95-gallon trash bins. The market analysis, that was not provided in our packet that we were given as adjoining property owners. I'd certainly be interested to have a look at that. I've provided you with a market analysis of properties that have actually sold in the last 12 months. And there are just no properties for $167 a square foot. And we're talking about properties that are well above 1,588 square feet. I also happen to, and I regret, I did not bring it today, but I happen to have I've lost my train of thought. I happen to have an evaluation of the house. The appraisal. There. I have an appraisal done that was done last fall. That appraisal brought me, and I live three properties down from this proposed development, and that appraisal brought back an appraised price on over 2,500 square foot of above grade square foot finished, with over 1,500 square foot below grade that is unfinished, and it brought back $131 a square foot. And I'm talking about a property that also has a 1.08 acre land with it and a three car garage. So I'm not really sure where the $167 a square foot per value comes from. Certainly finishes help in that, and they can bring a little bit more. But I do have an appraisal from last fall that brought a price of $318 on an over 4,000 square foot house. And that sits right across the street from the golf course. One other thing to mention, the packet that was sent out to the adjoining property owners, it did have an elevation that was a fall-away lot. As we saw in the elevation that was recently submitted here, it looks like we're talking about a land that merely comes up to the back patio area. Well, this is a fall-away lot, okay? But it also did not show any kind of a retaining wall, or possibly, if they're planning, just a long, drawn-out hill that runs down into a sewer ditch, and that sort of thing. So it is a fall-away lot. I would wonder if we're talking about a large retaining wall that would be constructed back there to provide for that elevation difference. And I digress. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Merrill. Who would like to speak next? Get your name and address for the record, please.
Susan Cohen, 5124 Arrowshire Drive, LaGrange. I live in Heather Hill. I was one of the uninformed nearby residents that was not part of the 55 families being informed about this property change, resident zoning change prior to just a couple of weeks ago. And I would like to thank this gentleman on Sadler's Mill, because I concur and agree with everything that he has said about the concerns that myself have on this new zoning change. Sadler Mills Road is a very narrow, barely two-lane, one way in, one way out road. And while the applicant is saying that there's didn't need a traffic study and there isn't much traffic on that road, that's not true. There are cars, there are people jogging, there are people walking their dogs, there are people driving their golf carts, and it's very difficult going up and down those with the blind curves and things to even anticipate what you're gonna come upon with the traffic that is now. Adding this to that would certainly impact it. I also don't appreciate that I was part of the uninformed residents. I would think that if somebody wanted to get buy-in to the community, that they would be willing to talk to and explain their reasoning and their thought and their, to all of the residents that would be impacted, not just 55. I feel that they didn't take into account people that live that have to go past that property. I have lived in other places in Oldham County, and I can guarantee you that if this property had been on Sadler's Mill when I bought our house in Heather Hill, I mean, I wouldn't have gone there at all. So I would hope that you would take into consideration the over 200 people that did sign that petition. And I do know a number of those people, and they do live in the area. And they are going to be impacted and negatively impacted by this development. So I would hope that you would take into account the current zoning and keep it as one dwelling unit and not multifamily, because I can tell you most of the residents do not want this property and the zoning change. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Cohen. Anyone else?
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Danny Cox. I live at the property four doors down from this proposed property. I've lived there since 98.
Can you give us the address of that property,
please? 4701 Sadler's Mill Road, which is the real golf course view of the property, because I get their golf balls. And it's a beautiful place. I'm just not happy with what they're proposing. I think they ought to build some houses in there, just like the rest of the people have in the area. You know, I bought this property in 98, like I say, and I enjoy it. I like it. We have a problem sometime getting out with the traffic because of narrow roads, and also with people, as I've said before me, the joggers, the golf carts, runners, walking their dogs and all kinds of things in there, and somebody's going to get hit. But there's no curbs. There's a ditch on the golf course side. Of course, I get a lot of the leaves and the trash from up my way because I'm on the lower end. I'm glad to hear that they are going to have their water going that way, because I've had a problem with Morgan Place. In the back of my house is Morgan Place, and I made them put a ditch in the developers to cop the water because I got flooded out four times, and they said, oh, you'll never get that in 100 years. I said, well, my 100 years has been in the last 10. So, you know, I'm concerned with water, traffic, that many houses in one area and that many more vehicles on Sadler Mill Road just has a big concern.
Very well.
So if they widen the road would help, I don't know. But thank you for your time.
Thank you for your comments.
But I'm totally against it.
Anyone else speaking in opposition to this application? All right. We'll move into questioning of the applicant and those opposing the application by the commission. We can. All right.
Just remind everybody about ex parte.
We'll take, yeah, please mind. Please, folks, don't approach the commissioners to discuss the case. Commissioners refrain from discussing the case. We'll take 10.
10 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Ms. Albertson seems to think I'm running a marathon.